Welcome to this year's university lectures. Our young students who have not attended this event, this is our most prestigious lecture series. And this year we are honored to have Professor Ned Lewis from Caltech to give us three lectures. Today is his first lecture. If you don't know who Ned Lewis, you should Google Rolling Stone. And recently they have a list of agents who changed America. Number one on the list is Obama. Number three is Steve Jobs. Number 17 is Al Gore. Number 18 is Al Gore. And guess who is number 17 on the list? It's Professor Lewis here. So we're truly honored to have him here. And I'll try to keep my today's introduction brief. If I have to say anything I wanted to say, or I really have to say about Professor Lewis in one shot, we'll take the entire afternoon. So Ned started his scientific career at Caltech as an undergraduate student with Harry Gray. Back then, I believe he studied rhodium chemistry. I could be wrong. But after graduation in 1977, he moved to MIT, a small institute across the river from here, where he studied photoelectrochemistry with Mark Wrighton, who is currently, has been over 20 years, the chancellor of Washington University in St. Louis. He graduated in 4 years, 1981, and started his independent career as assistant professor at Stanford. In his own words, he couldn't find any postdocs, so he started his assistant professorship right away. He has been at Stanford from 1981 to 86 as assistant professor, and then from 86 to 88 as associate professor. That's why he decided to move back to Caltech and has been there since. So he is currently George Agarwal, I probably pronounced it wrong, George Agarwal's professor of chemistry. In the division, the chemistry division. He was one of the first researchers to study the semiconductor electrochemistry. In the early days for his study at Stanford, for instance, they used this redox shuttle as a means to harvest solar energy. They create solar cells based on semiconductor liquid junctions. And this research later matured to reactions such as what we are going to hear today. In 2010, Professor Lewis started this massive project called Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis. This is between Caltech and Berkeley. It's being funded by the Department of Energy. I think it's more than $150 million received funding, and they're doing great. He served as a director for the Joint Center, known as JECA. You see here. Until 2013, he is currently the scientific director of this joint center. So one of the many, he holds many appointments. One of the many appointments I wanted to mention, especially wanted to mention, is the editor-in-chief of the Royal Chemical Society journal, Energy and Environmental Science. The journal he started in 2009. He only less than 8 years, 7 years, really. And his journal has approached the status with an impact factor, something you may or may not care, over 20. So that means that the average citations of the articles published in 2 years were cited more than 20 times. It's quite a high impact factor for a young journal. So it's not surprising that Professor Lewis' research has received many awards over the years. I just name a few, including the Sloan Fellow, the Dreyfus Teacher Scholar Award, SAS Award in Pure Chemistry. He was also a presidential young investigator. His research really covers a wide range of the spectrum of chemistry and semiconductor physics and devices. And the first lecture he will give today is on the semiconductor photoelectrochemistry for artificial photosynthesis or solar energy harvesting. And tomorrow it will tell us about the semiconductor surface modification and study how to modify the surface with chemical means. And on Friday it will tell us interesting story on electronic nodes. Over the years, he has trained many students, and if you come back tomorrow, I'll promise you to tell the story about the people he has trained. But for today, I'll stop right here. Let's put our hands together and welcome Professor Lewis.
Most of my time already with the introduction, so it's great to be here, and thanks so much for coming. I'm going to tell you three different stories about research projects that are going on in our lab. They're complementary, but very different, and you would argue that they could almost be in different fields. So if you come tomorrow, I actually decided I would tell you about, instead of semiconductor surface modification per se, about a project that's really taken off in the last couple years that we started inadvertently on how we discovered materials that can grow toward an uncorrelated beam of light like a sunflower does in your backyard, and they move their growth direction as you move that beam of light. And it's a very interesting phenomenon of the interactions between light and matter that may well be heretofore undiscovered. So I thought that was very interesting. And then Friday, I will tell you about our electronic nose. They all have in common the theme that despite the fact that we, like many other people, are very proud that we have powerful instrumentation and equipment and can study things, as you'll see, in as much exquisite detail as modern instrumentation and theory will let us do, at their core, there are things you could do for under $2 for a junior high school science supply kit. And I think most of the interesting, really interesting things in science that are left come about from this kind of philosophy of actually distilling down what nature has to tell us into just fundamentally simple things and then studying them in detail, not just studying things in detail to somehow clarify the fact that it's complicated in the first place. Today I'll tell you about our big publicized project, as Dunaway said, over the last decade, and that's to figure out how to get this airplane off of the ground. We're the Wright brothers trying to actually figure out a way to beat nature at its own game, and instead of using photosynthesis naturally, which is not very efficient and makes a product we can't use, but to make something that is efficient, not to trade food for fuel, and something that we can use. I thank the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis, which is the DOE's Energy Innovation Hub, for support. The National Science Foundation's Center for Chemical Innovation actually started this earlier in our labs. I've had core support from the NSF and the DOE Basic Energy Sciences that really fostered the incubating ideas for this, along with the Air Force. And more recently, the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation has helped pick this up. If you want more details about the rationale, it's made it into some of the popular media, and in addition to review articles, if you were to look, for instance, at Bill Gates's latest call for energy miracles, you will see that this is highlighted in many of his recent interviews as something the world could really benefit from. And the reason for that is there's a compelling case for the fact that the sun, and for different reasons, of course, the wind, although the tremendous resource potential is there for clean, sustainable energy, the sun has this nasty little habit. It goes out locally every single night. Now, nature figured out the best way to store energy is in chemical bonds. The energy density in the best battery is 200 watt hours in a kilogram. The energy density in gasoline is 12,000 watt-hours in a kilogram. You don't need to know anything more to know why we will be range-challenged for a long time in electric vehicles. On the other hand, chemical bonds, although they're a great way to store energy, photosynthesis gets an A for inspiration but a D-minus for execution, because even in the fastest-growing crop, if you take the total solar energy that hits a square acre over a year and divide that into the total free energy of all the biomass made by the fastest growing crop,
it's less than 1% efficient of energy in divided into energy out. And then it's downhill from there to count the energy needed to go and get that and grow it and process it and refine it and get it to a fuel we can use instead of that lignocellulose stuff. And that's the fundamental reason why we face trading food for fuel and other issues with biofuels, is because you start from a machine that, in an engineering design class, if I gave students an exam and said, design a machine, and they came back with one that was 1% efficient, they probably wouldn't get a good grade in their design project. So we can learn from that. Semiconductors and solar cells can be 20 or 30% efficient, but they make the wrong product. They make electricity. Electricity can't be stored. Edison learned about that and said so in 1931 when talking to Henry Ford. And we've since come to realize that he that cannot store shall not have power after four. And so we have to find a way to do that. And making fuel solves both the grid storage problem and the decarbonizing of transportation, because there ain't no such thing as a plug-in hybrid airplane. And so we have to find a way to make carbon neutral liquid fuels in order to run that 40% of transportation that can't be electrified, no matter how many plug-in hybrids we use on light-duty vehicles. Well, this works. This is a mineral, strontium titanate. You may have seen regionally some claims that solar-driven water splitting is a new phenomenon within the last 5 years. But in fact, this is a 40-year-old video from a colleague of mine in Japan. This shows that strontium titanate and materials like it split water with an efficiency from light that's greater on a free energy out to free energy in basis than the fastest growing planet already, even though the band gap of this material is over 3 EV, it looks white, and so it hardly absorbs any of the sunlight, which means that if we could make a material that did this, that absorbed much more of the solar spectrum, we could do 10 or 20 times better than the fast-growing plant. Claims that this is somehow new and novel wireless photoelectric chemistry begat the demonstration of this by Mark Wrighton, in fact, at MIT in 1970-something, 75, I believe it was, here across the river. So what's the lessons learned after 40 years of photoelectric chemistry? There are four things you would like. You would like it to be cheap, you would like it to be efficient, you would like it to be long-lasting, and you would like it to be safe, unlike co-evolution of hydrogen and oxygen in the same place at the same time. The best we can do now is get two, or maybe three, but not the fourth at the same time. Materials that are safe, cheap, and efficient don't last. Materials that are safe, efficient, and cheap are robust, and on and on and on. So we came to realize that there must be a design principle that survived from nature that would maybe get us a way to think about scientists as materials by design, get us out of that paradigm of finding the one magic material that would accomplish all four of those things at once, because without them all, we have nothing. Well, nature gives us a blueprint. The blueprint is that it does not use one photosystem, it uses two photosystems. And the reason fundamentally derives from the first law of thermodynamics. Unlike in a solar panel, when you can trade current for voltage, a silicon solar panel gives you half a volt and 20 milliamps of current, and a gallium arsenide one would give you 1 volt and 10. But that's the same power because it's current times voltage. But when you're splitting water or making a fuel, you have that pesky little first law of thermodynamics that says if you need 1.23 volts and you get 1.22 volts, it doesn't matter how much current you get nothing because you can't do it. So one, high energy photon is not the recipe for success, but two low energy photons summed together like two D cell batteries in a series, trading energy in the sense of voltage for current, is nature's blueprint for success. Now it uses two chlorophylls that are not well designed because they're about the same light absorption threshold, so they fight for photons with each other. So if we're going to redesign this machine, we're going to redesign it in a way that we can do better instead of starting off with a bad design in the first place. We can learn other things. One is that the way the material survives both being in an oxidizing and reducing environment is it's compartmentalized. The water oxidation catalyst, the oxygen-evolving complex, the manganese cluster and photosystem II, source of all oxygen in our atmosphere, is not reductively stable, but it never sees a reducing environment. The reducing proteins that make the fuel that power biological systems, ATP, NADH, and so on, hydrogenase, nitrogenases, they're not oxidatively stable, but they don't see an oxidizing environment. By compartmentalizing these, not only do you prevent recombination, but you relax the constraints that the material must be both oxidatively and reductively stable in the same place at the same time. The other things that we see are, of course, because the solar photons come in one at a time, and we have to make and break chemical bonds, is that we need catalysts to do these multi-electron transfer reactions. Both water oxidation and proton reduction and or CO2 fixation to make fuel. And finally, because electrons move across that membrane, that means to neutralize charge in a sustainable way, protons must move also to neutralize the pH gradient. So we need a membrane to separate the products, and we need that membrane to pass protons to prevent a deleterious pH gradient from building up that will simply shut the system down by the laws of chemistry that we teach people in high school. Those five system components are, we think, a good blueprint for the natural photosynthetic system. Now, there's one more point. Why don't we just take a solar cell or a solar panel and then put it as our component for light absorbers and hook it up to some fuel-forming system? Because solar panels cost too much money and electrolyzers cost too much money to make this credible at scale, and we know how much they cost at scale, and it's not even very close to affordable compared to fossil fuel. If you want more details on the cost of these things, I just wrote a cost-based review that was technically grounded in Science magazine. It appeared in late January, and you can see all of the peer-reviewed numbers and snapshot of the field as of now, compared to where it was even 10 years ago. Consider a silicon photovoltaic cell. You need about 200 microns of silicon to absorb the light. Any more silicon wastes expensive silicon, any less wastes photons. The reason that silicon needs to be so pure and costs so much money is because what goes in has to come out. If a photon is absorbed very deeply, it must last long enough in the excited state to make it all the way back to the surface, the same 200 microns, to make electricity. Because if it recombines along the way, all you get is heat, and you might have used asphalt instead. We said that there would be a way around that in concept, that after 50 years of building planarized solar cells since they were discovered at Bell Laboratories, that we would take advantage of a different structure where we would have a highly anisotropic framework where we would have basically a forest of aspen trees with a long axis to absorb the light and a short axis to move carriers a short distance sideways. And by decoupling absorption and then transport and orthogonalizing them, we should be able to use very cheap materials because we could adjust the ratio of anisotropy to accommodate light absorption and charge transport in different ways. In addition, if we put this framework into a material, it naturally had lots of void volume that could be conformally filled by the liquid that not only would collect those carriers to make fuel, but it also provides a natural path for the protons that are needed to go through the membrane to follow the path of the electrons and have the least possible resistance pathway. Because we know that even electrons need grid lines to not make resistance through solids. Protons in solution are much less mobile than electrons in solids, and if we have to make them go over long distances, we'll have unacceptably high IR drops, resistance drops, and the system will just waste all the energy we generated. So that's another good design. That evolved into this so-called Liz, who's not here now. She works in Boston, Liz Santori, who was a graduate student in my group, who was good at Adobe Illustrator at the time. And after a group retreat, when we concocted this scheme, our blueprint that is now around the world for the past decade for how you would do this, we call this the Liz. Her initials are somewhere, microfiche in there, but nobody's yet found where it is, and she won't tell. But you can see the idea. We want two photosystems, one that looks red because it absorbs the blue, one that looks blue because it absorbs red. They'll be current matched, unlike fighting for photons in the chlorophylls. That's a good design. We're going to have water oxidation catalysts to liberate the oxygen that we need to form to provide the electron donor that's sustainable for the electrons on the top to vent into the air. And then we'll have a hydrogen evolution catalyst and or a CO2 reduction catalyst on the bottom in a membrane that passes protons that will then create a material that looks like a high-performance rain jacket that you just roll out that wicks up water from the sun and then generates fuel outside on the bottom. So it's not a solar panel. It does not make electricity. It doesn't look like anything yet discovered on our Earth, except that it would solve both of those key clean energy problems in one fell swoop. Well, that vision got us an NSF Center. It also was the basis with some more work for the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis. But at the time, other than five components, we actually had none of those pieces. So this didn't exist outside of this cartoon schematic and is therefore a lesson in materials by design. So I get to spend the remainder of this talk telling you the progress that we've made over the last decade in making this a reality. There'll be various components and various materials discovery and development, and it's not a done deal. We are close, but we're not done. So I'm being a little unconventional here and not telling you that we've done this project and reviewing our recent results and then leaving with a fanfare and saying we solved this problem. We're close, but we haven't yet solved it, and I want to bring you up to date. The other thing that I have the luxury of is that from now on, every slide is some postdoc or graduate student's entire work effort in one slide. You'll see that one slide is somebody's PhD thesis. The next one is someone's postdoc. And the goal in my group now is to work hard enough that you get one slide your boss's talk when you're done. Let's start. We first wanted to show that there was something to this idea of aspen trees as photon forests and that they would be credible. We did modeling and simulation in conjunction with Harry Atwater and showed that it should work in theory. We drilled holes in a piece of silicon and showed that if we did that and made Swiss cheese out of a perfectly good silicon wafer and infiltrated it with a liquid, that it did work. We showed that we could grow materials from the bottom up like cadmium selenide and that they could function. And so we laid the basis early on that this wasn't a harebrained idea, that there was credibility to the architecture. But that didn't mean we could do it with the materials that we cared about. For the bottom material, we wanted a 1.1 EV material that could not be reduced, so silicon fits that bill. The top material we knew would yet to be identified. We had no good way of growing from the bottom up silicon wires with the needed architecture and purity, and so we developed that. You can't electrodeposit silicon very well, if at all, in a credible form, but you can develop and use the so-called vapor-liquid-solid growth method. This has been known since Wagner and Ellis discovered it in 1964. It's now the poster child of the nanoscience community. My first graduate student, Charlie Lieber, across the river, uses this all the time and grows a nanowire and then publishes a paper on the cover of Science or Nature apparently every week by doing so. That's wonderful, but it's not what we can do because we need them all pointing toward the sun, not just one removed from a nanowire-based felt. We struggled with this for a long time. We used painstaking photolithography to deposit metals like gold. There are only three metals that the phase diagram supports the VLS growth: gold, copper, and nickel. And when we did that, we never got good oriented wires. And what we discovered pretty rapidly is that under growth conditions, even though we painstakingly put the metal just where we wanted the wires to grow with the right diameter and pattern, we got them all over the place and of all different orientations like everybody else. Because when we looked at the growth substrate after 30 seconds, even without the silicon precursor there, the metals had obviously glommed up, the technical term is Oswald ripened on the surface. And so since they moved, then we started from this template, even though we thought we started from that template. We got around that by putting seeds in pots. And so we made a silicon oxide intervening buffer layer that we etch holes in. And now the metal's confined by the oxide, it can't move anywhere. Then we get smart, and we say we know the surface tension of the molten silicon metal eutectic as it's growing on the diameter of the wire that we want. And we make the height just so we get the surface tension so the droplet just covers that diameter of wire. If it's too thick, then it's going to drip down the side like wax down a candle. We get filaments everywhere. If it's too thin, it's going to ball up. We'll get filaments everywhere. When it's just right for that given diameter wire, then we'll support the vapor liquid solid growth. The more silicon we feed, the more it will dissolve into that liquid eutectic. And then it crystallizes at the interface. And this droplet just grows on top like seeds growing on top of a growing stalk of corn everywhere we put metal. The metal can't go anywhere because it's confined by the pattern. We now, as you'll see, don't use lithography even because on this scale we can use George Whiteside's developed contact printing to just stamp these patterns anywhere we want. And when we do that with that pattern, we grow these beautiful single crystals of silicon as microwires. They're growing along the thermodynamic 111 growth direction on a 111 epitaxial substrate. We see that by TEM. We see they're nearly 100% uniform over an entire wafer scale in 10 or 20 minutes. And we would be considered crazy because we know that this is gold saturated silicon and that the minority carrier lifetime in silicon that has a lot of gold in it is limited by the traps of gold and won't be more than 2 microns. And we need 200 microns to absorb the light. And so in a normal planar solar cell, the first 2 microns would be photoactive and the other 198 would be dead because the carriers would recombine before they got back to the top. But not so in our case. Because there's a little sanity here and method behind the madness because we have 200 microns to absorb the light, but the carriers only have to move 2 microns or less in diameter to be collected. We filled this up with a test liquid. We showed this would work. We checked the box. Now there were two things about this that weren't where we wanted to be. The first is that we don't really want to use gold with a lifetime killer. And second, when we had gold there, we couldn't control the doping, and these turned out to be N-type. And that's an oxidatively unstable condition for silicon to make oxide. We want it to be the cathode where it can't be chemically reduced. We solved that problem with going to copper as the catalyst. Copper's better because we can electroplate it, like plating a printed circuit board. It's cheaper and we can recycle it. But more importantly, it's well tolerated as an impurity in silicon. Now, people also thought we were crazy for using copper because everyone knows that copper wasn't for a long time in the silicon industry because its diffusion coefficient in silicon is almost like an ion in water. It's 10 to the minus 7 centimeters squared at room temperature. And so it blurs out all your junctions and goes everywhere. Well, this is perfect for us. Because as we seed and then grow, we can then oxidize the wires, get the copper out the sides, and it's all gone with a quick etch. And so we can then recycle and reuse that copper and purify that sample all at once. This works. Here's an example of copper-catalyzed VLS-grown silicon microwires. I'll tell you much more about why micro instead of nano in a little bit. These can be controllably doped, and we can make them with boron doping in the gas phase feed, which is done in this toaster oven from the VLS growth at atmospheric pressure. So it's a very scalable method with no purification of the silicon and no crystallization deliberately into something that can be very high photovoltaic activity. Well, this is just a stunt because we needed an epitaxial substrate to support that 111 growth direction of those wires. And so if we need that substrate in order to support this growth, then why did we go to all the trouble to do this? Why didn't we just use that silicon solar substrate in the first place? And it doesn't have the membrane or look like any of the other pieces. Well, I like to bet my graduate students little teeny token bets. And this one was a $1.98 bet that we could make this work with a supply from my local hardware store, which in my semi-rural area is the nearest Petco, because there isn't a hardware store. And I like to go shopping at Petco, and in this case, I got for under $2 a tube of fish tank goop, which is lovingly known chemically as RTV, or polydimethyl siloxane. Now, the reason I got that is because the beautiful work of John Rogers from Illinois, just moved to Northwestern, showed at a seminar that I was attending that polydimethyl siloxane, like other materials, has this interesting property that the rate at which you stress it, that its viscosity depends on the rate at which it's peeled, its stiffness. Just like a Band-Aid in hair, we all know this. If you peel it quickly, it's stiff and the hair comes off. If you peel it slowly, the Band-Aid comes off. And he's shown that this is a case for many materials, and including polydimethyl siloxane. And so we infiltrated it with a tube of that RTV that we bought from Petco. Kate Ploss, a postdoc, did that. I won the bet that this would work. We give it a razor blade shave that are like human hairs. We rip it off, and off come all the microwires in that flexible piece of plastic. We can process those microwires on that wafer. We can dope them. We can do anything we want, and then we can peel them off and get what we call the best kind of organic solar cell. It's an organic solar cell where the organic material absorbs none of the light. It's all absorbed by the silicon microwires. These are really interesting for many reasons. The first of which, what we end up with is little stubs of silicon that easily are dissolved in a quick dunk in KOH, where silicon will etch. And the oxide isn't. And that means we leave behind the holes that expose the substrate that we can just electrodeposit more copper that then we can put back into our toaster oven and grow more silicon microwires that then we can peel and start over and over again, so we use that same substrate like printing money, making lithography, in this case making a lithograph out of a stamp now of our stamped copper dots and electroplating, just like making a printed circuit board. This is all atmospheric pressure. None of this costs very much money. And it's a scalable, kerfless way with no losses to grow very pure silicon in this microwire array format. We can make ohmic contacts to the bottom. We can also, as you can see here, develop a method not to fully embed the material, but to partially embed it. We do that by adding a high vapor pressure boiling monomer when the polymer is curing, so it evaporates, so we get a thin layer of the polymer at the bases if we want. Or we can make bologna sandwiches with an insoluble layer in the middle and a sacrificial polymer on top and bottom. And so we can put these materials anywhere we want, and then you see this starts to look more like what I told you we were going for. These materials are also interesting because this is a beautiful experiment with a laser pointer, just like this one, that can be used to illustrate to freshmen what diffraction is all about. Here are a bunch of templates of metal, lithographically established for various reasons. These are SEM images of the microwires to show that they grow where and only where the metal is formed. Then we peel them off after impregnating them with the fish tank goop and then rolling it up and unrolling it, and then shine a laser pointer just like this one through that, and you can see four orders of diffraction that are obviously the reciprocal space of the real space images here that we imposed on the pattern in the first place. So these materials retain their periodicity because there's no load on the bases of the microwires when you've done this peeling and rolling and unrolling them. Now, the bad news is that we did this because standard test conditions for a solar cell are the one time of day, one day of the year, when the sun is overhead in both axes. There's only one such instant, but that's the standard test condition. For our architecture, that's the worst test condition, right? Because that's the only time where the photons go right through most of the array. Any other time, it's like being on Southwest Airlines when the seats are all back, filling up all space. There'll be lots of scattering, and off axis, they look black. But right on axis, they don't absorb much light that one instant. We wanted to fix that. We tried chirping and all sorts of other patterns, could never really eliminate the dead spot at normal incidence, But we found a way to do that that I'll tell you about in a little bit. I alluded to the fact that we don't even use lithography anymore. We use contact printing and stamping to make these templates. And so everything is basically done at room temperature with simple methods. We don't use photolithography even to make our mask, although we could, but we don't need to. We removed those microwires and showed they were good electronically. This is a bad geometry. We're going to have one microwire not pointing up toward the sun. We're going to make a PN radial junction with that. And it's going to be optically thin because of its geometry. It only absorbs about 50% of the light, even with the silver back reflector. But we want to see just how good the photovoltaic performance of this wire is. Because there were lots of silicon nanowire measurements, thousands, that showed you couldn't make really high efficiency PN junctions out of these radial nanowires. And nano gets your paper published, but doesn't necessarily get you the performance you want. And I've only talked about micro. We started out with nano. And we immediately transitioned to micro based on our theory, which showed that micro is much better than nano for silicon, because I've already told you that even in the worst case, carriers move 2 microns. If I make the diameter of the wire smaller than that, all I've done is added more junction recombination area to an array and not increase the collection. If I make it bigger than that, I decrease the collection. The optimum diameter is when the dimension of the radius matches that of the carrier collection length, which is on the micron regime. And so we showed that by making a microwire in this 50% absorption optical geometry, we made a 9% efficient photovoltaic cell with no new physics. If we had 100% absorption, this would be an 18% efficient single microwire silicon PN junction cell. To calibrate you, the best silicon solar cells on planar, perfect silicon crystallized, are basically 22%. So we're pretty close to that. We made a photovoltaic array by doing this with haptolite absorption silicon microwires that are not very good conformal indium tin oxide top contact. We showed that when it only absorbed half of the light, because we didn't have enough scatterers in there, that it was 7% real energy conversion efficiency, power out divided by total power in from the sun. We also showed we got around that normal incidence problem by going back to Petco, and instead of getting clear fish tank goop, getting the white fish tank goop. What's in the white stuff? The white stuff has titanium or silica optical scatterers in it as mechanical binders. That's why it looks white. That's perfect for us, because if you have an optical scatter at the base of the wires, photons that would have gone through get scattered back into the structure. The index of refraction of silicon is 3.5. And an index medium of liquid water is like 1.3. And so once a photon gets absorbed, it multiply internally reflects. It doesn't come out of the wires. But we don't care about those microwires to make solar cells. We care about them to take advantage of this ability to make a photocathode. The first thing we did is to use platinum just to demonstrate that this would work, that we could make a microwire-based silicon photocathode to build up that piece of our array. Another dirty little secret here is that if you have metal like platinum that everybody knows is a good hydrogen evolution catalyst, by the time you plate enough of it on a light-absorbing semiconductor to get catalytic efficiency, you've already made it a metal film that's thick enough that you reflect or absorb all the light. And so nothing gets through. People use backside illumination, but you can't illuminate the backside of both of the systems at the same time. So we have to have some strategy to actually get light into a material while having a catalyst there. We don't have to worry about that in the microwire array, because all we have to do is get enough catalyst on the sidewalls so that a carrier gets to a catalyst before it recombines. It need not be planar on the top. We showed that was the case. Now we don't know what the optimal architecture is. So we don't yet know whether or not they should be rods or funnel cones, whether it should have little pointy tips and nucleate a hydrogen bubble at the top, whether we should have bubbles in the bottom and refract light. We don't know what the mass transport properties are. And if you wanted to work on that, that's what I want a first-year graduate student in my group to do in what we call 3D coupled electrochemistry with optics and chemical engineering in it, because that's really a kind of frontier that no one knows about yet. So we'll go with the microwires to show some things, but we know that that's not necessarily the architecture we would need in the end for optimization. These lightly platinized silicon photocathodes at one sun with some scatterers in it, so they only absorb 50% of the light, are still on a thermodynamic basis almost 6% efficient solar to hydrogen producing cathodes. They're stable because you can't reduce silicon and you can't reduce platinum. With no new physics or chemistry, we would have an over 10% efficient photocathode by itself based on this microwire array to reduce water to hydrogen. We demonstrated that, published it in Science, and had to move on. There were two things at least that we need still. One is that we can't split water, which is silicon microwire arrays, because they only give you half a volt of voltage. You need 1.23 to do that. We did show recently, Shane Ardo showed that you could make a silicon microwire array and platinize the bottom, and at least you could split HI into H2 and I2 this way, and show that it works. And I left out a feature here, which is going to be key later on. We're not limited to polydimethyl siloxane as that membrane. This is a Nafion membrane, and so it passes protons and blocks gases, and is what's used in electrolyzers and fuel cells. And we've made many membranes as the transfer agent this way, so we don't limit it just to PDMS, which is a very good generalization. I'm going to skip this step and go on. Aha. So now we need two. Well, we showed we could make two, this dual microwire, right? It looked like the LIS kind of 4 years later, not by using epitaxial growth, but just by laminating plastic, like making a driver's license. We grew an array and peeled it. We grew another array and peeled it. And then the technical term is we smushed them together. And when you smush them together, that's what you get. Now the aficionados will know that because the top microwires aren't aligned with the bottom microwires, we need a conducting intermediate baloney plane in our sandwich. That happens to be P.PSS that works well to make an ohmic contact to both N plus silicon and P silicon. We've done single microwire array measurements of that with Mike Freund to make pressure-based contacts to show that conductance works. And so we would love to have that there, but we do, and this is one of those things that shows you we made that come to life. In addition, we can do it with the alkaline equivalent of Nafion, where instead of on the backbone, we have sulfonate groups that are fixed. We have quaternary ammonium groups that are fixed, so it passes hydroxides instead of passing protons. So it works in locally alkaline media instead of locally acidic media. And I'll come back to why that's important in about two slides. Well, these things, to get rid of the pesky little P dot, we then re-optimized and said, maybe we don't want the microwires top and bottom necessarily. Maybe we want a core shell structure where they're all on top, and so they're self-aligned. And we showed that we could do that in a structure with, in this case, gallium arsenide micro or nanowires and silicon microwires, and having a tungsten oxide shell that we electrode deposit or CVD deposit. We need to do this to show that we can build a construct that splits water, but this is self-aligned. And because the membrane penetrates the silicon p-n junction microwire, we need not have that conducting plane in between because the wires on the top match the wires going through the bottom. And so this eliminates that one other materials constraint that we need. It brings other trades, but this works. This does split water, although not very efficiently, and we knew that. Because for the aficionados, you'll know that not only is the band gap of tungsten oxide too big to be optimal, but its band edge position is not matched well to the silicon voltage to really give you a good current match position. But more on how we get to that next set of magic materials that are going to give us that top stable light absorber that was unknown in about five slides. These things look real. Here's a membrane in Nafion of these embedded materials. This blocks gases, it passes protons, it does everything we need to do to split water, except that we don't have the water oxidation system on top under control at this point. And this one works in alkaline media because it's got, instead of on the fixed site sulfonic acid passing cations that are protons, it's got fixed sites that are cations passing anions that are hydroxide. Now, why do we only limit ourselves to locally acidic or locally alkaline media and not just go under the pretension that we could make this work at neutral pH just out of regular tap water? Well, it's the laws of chemistry that are the little pesky problems here. When you oxidize water, you liberate protons. When you reduce water, you consume protons. And that means there will be a pH gradient between the anode and the cathode when you actually pass current, even in buffered electrolyte, that you can stir away if you choose to do so, and therefore co-evolve stoichiometric explosive mixtures of hydrogen and oxygen, or prevent it with a membrane. And there's only two choices. If you're working at neutral pH and you've got a buffer, then the concentration of the sodium and salts are going to be much higher than the protons, and so the buffer will move in what's called electrodialysis, leaving you with two gradients, the proton pH gradient you started with and the electrodialysis gradient, and the system simply shuts down. Or you can work under the only two conditions that neutralize the pH gradient in a passive way, safely. Let protons follow the electrons, or let hydroxides go with the electrons, protons going the other way. Only two ways that can work. This is the reason that all commercial electrolyzers over the past 100 years have been developed only in acidic or in alkaline media, because they simply have never been designed to be safe and efficient at the same time under any other conditions. So we only care about them. And therefore, we only care about catalysts that work, where a system can be safe and efficient work in locally acidic or locally alkaline media. This is the only slide so far, in fact, in the talk that I'm not an author on. It was done by the JCAP benchmarking group. And it shows you the state of catalysts in that low overpotential is better. And if you take the overpotential at zero, and as a metric of some stability, the overpotential after 2 hours being near zero and along the 45 degree line is the best, because then it's stable and is low overpotential. You can see we had pretty good, but not necessarily earth abundant, catalysts for hydrogen evolution acid. And we have some very good ones like nickel, molybdenum, and base. We had a whole lot of pretty moderately good ones in alkaline media for water oxidation, like nickel iron, but really nothing other than iridium oxide for water oxidation in acidic media. Now, if you chose to put on this graph, where things like cobalt oxyhydroxide at near neutral pH and phosphate buffer would lie, even though we can't build a system that would be safe and efficient there, they would lie off this graph here. So they're very inefficient because it's harder to oxidize water than it is to oxidize a negative hydroxide. And so it's much better kinetically to oxidize things in base than it is to oxidize things at neutral pH. We wanted to change that landscape. And so we reasoned that hydrodesulfurization, which is a common refining catalyst class of families, that shares a common intermediate with hydrogen evolution, because in a hydrodesulfurization reaction, you take things like thiophene and hydrogen and then reduce that to make a thiol, and the intermediate is an association and dissociation of H2 to make metal hydrides on the surface. That same metal hydride intermediate is what we want in the low temperature electrochemical formation of hydrogen from protons. So we reason that high-temperature hydrodesulfurization catalysts might be good hunting grounds for low-temperature hydrogen evolution catalysts. There's no guarantee that these mechanisms are the same, but after 100 years of no credible earth-abundant, low-overpotential, acid-stable hydrogen evolution catalysts, it was as good a place to start as any. Well, in addition, we had some theoretical guidance. Because in 2005, Jose Rodriguez at Brookhaven National Lab, a theorist, had also made this same analogy and has gone further and predicted that nickel phosphide, metal phosphides that are covalent or acid stable, not ionic like zinc phosphide that make phosphine gas. Covalent ones, they're acid stable. They are good hydrogen, they are good hydrodesulfurization catalysts. And he predicted that they would be good hydrogen evolution catalysts based on some theory that he did. But they hadn't been made. So we got together with Ray Schock's group at Penn State, who made nickel phosphide nanoparticles. That was our first shot, and we showed they were acid stable, and their overpotential to get to our current density of 10 millimeters per centimeter squared was only 120 millivolts overpotential. But we opened up an entirely new family of Earth-abundant hydrogen evolution catalysts with this one observation. That one paper in the last 2 years has been cited almost 300 times already. There are 300 weeks between when we published it and now. There's been hundreds of Earth-abundant metal phosphides and phosphosulfides explored. Since then, we didn't stand still. We explored cobalt phosphide, it went down to 85 millivolts. We explored molybdenum phosphide, it was a little bit better, 90 millivolts. Iron phosphide was 55 or 60 millivolts. Tom Jaramillo's group has now made molybdenum phosphosulfide that Jens Norskov claims is at the top of the volcano curve. It's down to 50 millivolts. In our view, it doesn't matter anymore. When you're tweaking out the last 10 millivolts when needing 1.23 volts, it's diminishing returns, and we've replaced the platinum with Earth-abundant materials that are kinetically just great for hydrogen evolution at the current densities that we care about. Now, there's one other dirty little secret that I told you about, that these things on a per site basis are not as active as platinum. We have to load them more, and therefore they're going to reflect more light. And if you make the materials, they're black. They look black or absorbing or metallic. But in a microlayer way, we can load them up at the bases on below our scatterers. The titanium dioxide scatterers are there, and then these act as a metal mirror, and so they reflect photons back into the structure. And we can get enough by filling that volume to get our kinetic activity and not worry about light absorption. And we built nickel phosphide-based active photocathodes and cobalt phosphide-based active photocathodes that are essentially indistinguishable from platinum. We've obviated the need for platinum in this system. What we don't have is we still don't have the substitute for an acid-stable iridium oxide equivalent. That's something the field still could use to get to global scalability, because iridium is, after all, the scarcest element in the periodic table on Earth, found in meteorites, and there's not enough to get to a terawatt scale based on the loadings that we anticipate having to use. But we've obviated the need for precious metals in both alkaline media, which pre-exists our work, and now in acidic media on the hydrogen evolution side. I've got two more final pieces of this story to bring you up on, too. One is, how much better should we be able to do with further catalyst development? This was a pretty heretical analysis we did. Because we actually build real devices and build real systems, we were in a position to do a sensitivity analysis based on a so-called one factor at a time change. In this real device that we have operating, we said, how much better would it get if we reduce the overpotential for the catalysts compared to improving the design, compared to improving the light absorbers, compared to doing something else with our time and efforts and energy? Nobody likes to do this, because that says that someone's research is actually more important to make advantage on the long lever in the tent than somebody else's. But we really care about solving the problem, not just about publishing papers, although it's good to do that along the way. So we did this one factor at a time sensitivity analysis. And we showed that, in fact, from where we are now with the total overpotentials for hydrogen and oxygen of 450 millivolts, that if we reduce it to 350 by working on a little bit better water oxidation catalyst, that it barely affects the performance, no matter where you are on the light absorber curve. But bad light absorbers give you low efficiency, and good light absorbers give you high efficiency. Basically, it is neither necessary nor sufficient to make an improved water oxidation catalyst to make an improvement in our system. The long pole and the tent all resides now, except for very minor improvements in efficiency in matching the light absorbers. Whether or not you're at the so-called Shockley-Queisser limit, or whether or not you're degraded by 21 orders of magnitude from that, you can't make an inefficient light absorber efficient by a little bit better catalyst. And getting a little bit better catalyst barely changes the efficiency of what already was a 20% efficient system to only 21% efficient. So we need to go and get that last light absorber, because we've been working on silicon on the bottom and I've been punting on what's going to go on the top. Because we use tungsten oxide, we know that's a wrong band gap, and I like to say that as long as I've been alive, since the day I was born in 1955, from Heinz Gerischer, the great semiconductor electrochemistry pioneer in Berlin, we've known that all the common band gap semiconductors that are used, like silicon and gallium arsenide and cadmium selenide, are unstable as photoanodes because they oxidize or corrode in water. And there has not been a credible alternative since then, in that 61 years, to using those materials or discovering a magic new one by high throughput methods that would allow you to stably oxidize water with the right band gap. Now that doesn't mean we shouldn't be looking, and in fact we are looking in a high throughput method to try to find such photoanodes. But in the meantime, a little dumb luck doesn't hurt. One of my postdocs, Shu Hu, now on the faculty at Yale, inadvertently, for another reason, took titanium dioxide that had been grown by atomic layer deposition that was on the order of 50 nanometers thick. Now, everybody knows that TiO2 has a very large band gap and should act as a tunnel barrier to holes at those thicknesses. And he put it in water and, by mistake, basically found that it wasn't a tunnel barrier. In fact, it stably allowed the silicon to oxidize water for hundreds of hours when the silicon would have, without the protective film, died in seconds. There is a nickel hydroxyoxide catalyst in islands on top. It's one of those earth-abundant water oxidation catalysts because TiO2 can't do that reaction, so we put it on top to protect it, as well as to catalyze that. What happens here? We've shown this works on gallium arsenide, gallium arsenide phosphide, cad sulfide, cad telluride, bismuth, vanadate, and entire classes of compounds and materials that we thought were off the table for a little over half a century have been shown with high efficiency to be useful and stable for water oxidation. We don't fully understand yet exactly the mechanism in detail by which the holes tunnel through the TiO2, but it's credible that they're the carbon-nitrogen impurities from the precursors in ALD that we use to make the TiO2 are introducing a defect band that we have spectroscopic evidence for that doesn't prove that that's where they're going, but does suggest that it's credible that they can tunnel through that film, presumably in the defect band. Now, we're not the first people to see this. In fact, TiO2 was not used as a gate dielectric because Intel rejected it in the 1990s because when made by ALD, it was too leaky. It leaked an amp per centimeter squared of current. They went to hafnium oxide, which is used in all the computers now as the gate, because it was a good barrier dielectric and TiO2 was way too leaky, which is exactly what we inadvertently rediscovered 20 years later in this context that we've made utility of. That paper appeared in Science about a year and a half ago. Silicon microwires are even more stable because the light intensity, although constant, distributes the carriers over a much higher internal area, so the current density is even lower here than it would be on a planar sample. And that means they're even more stable. We've run these things for thousands of hours, TiO2 protected. And because ALD is conformal, we can coat all the microwires this way. We like to say now that the semiconductors are more stable than all light sources we've tried but one, and that one is 93 million miles away. That's a pretty good position to be in 2 years after we thought there were no options on the table. Now, if you read the literature, you'll see we've done this another way by making transparent, metallic, protective, sputtered films with nickel oxide. That's beneficial as an alternative to the TiO2. Basically, they're inherently catalytically active, transparent, conductive oxides. We've developed that chemistry. The sputtered nickel oxides are better than the TiO2 in certain scenarios and worse in others. I don't want to get into those details, but I do want to say there's options on the table. We've used that TiO2 protection to show that we can take a tandem structure made out of 3-5s with the membrane, separate products, and make a 10% solar to hydrogen efficient system. Real measured free energy in the hydrogen out, real measured total energy in the sunlight going in, separated gases, intrinsically safe, could be made under pressure. This is actually a real performing system, not one that has fundamental things tied behind its back, like co-evolving gases or not working in alkaline or acidic media. Now, even these, we're careful, at scale, have defect-related problems. Unlike silicon with the 3-5s, which we realized, active corrosion by dissolution is a problem that has billions of dollars worth of R&D that's never been solved. That's why we paint our pipelines over and over again in bridges. Because if you have, or cars rust, when you have one active corrosion site by dissolution as opposed to passivation, silicon passivates, gallium arsenide dissolves. We had to work pretty hard to find a sample that was small enough in area that we wouldn't have a pinhole or a crack or defect so we could demonstrate that this could work. But we know that over large areas, that's going to be probably precluded or heroic. On the other hand, we can go back to corrosion science and say this probably way out of that. We showed that when we, and this is not published yet, but we just gratifyingly showed this a couple weeks ago, that if we made gallium arsenide nanowires, that a defect wouldn't propagate because it's not electrically connected to any of the other defects. Right? It can't dissolve the remainder of the material like rust on your car because we lose the one microwire where there's the dust particle or the corrosion, but that's it. It's on an insulated substrate, in this case a silicon substrate, and so these can run for much longer periods of time, showing that it's really an extrinsic phenomenon that controls the lifetime, not an intrinsic one, and we can actually have a benefit for the nanowires and kind of think about corrosion as corrosion science instead of just phenomenology. So I promised you this would be a progress report, which it is. But what we've done is we've taken this vision and with a lot of hard work and a lot of staying power, almost a decade later, think that we're almost there. We've shown the microwire array idea is probably going to persist. Whether it's really oriented like that, or blades of grass, or aspen trees is not particularly relevant to us. There's probably a there that probably does make sense and is a good design principle. And you probably want to have a core shell or one on top of the other in a membrane to separate the products. Those are going to survive. You'd like a catalyst here somewhere and manage the light. You'd like a catalyst there somewhere. We've replaced the platinum, we've got earth-abundant catalysts for the hydrogen evolution, we've got earth-abundant catalysts in alkaline media for the water oxidation, we've got membranes that are suitable and stable for both protons to move or hydroxide to move, we've shown we can embed the microwires, we've shown we can make the membranes. We've now shown all the pieces in alkaline media. We have to put the system together and show it all works together at the same time now. And we're trying to do that. In acid, we're still short. We don't have a stable phonoanode yet in acid, and we don't have a substitute for iridium yet for water oxidation in acid. Both of those things are still cards we'd like to turn up so that we can have another option to build this. And what our philosophy really here is, the first time we build this is not going to be the last time we build this. It's going to be like getting the Wright brothers off the ground. It's not going to be a 787 flying from New York to Tokyo. But it's going to show that it's possible, and then people are going to innovate and are going to substitute and have a platform to work on to make it work better. Because once something is invented and demonstrated, then it's been shown that if you care about it enough, you can probably find a way to make it work. And I would argue that the world probably should care about this a lot because of the implications of filling the need for both grid storage and for storage and fuel for transportation. I'm going to close by thanking the people that do the work. They're a fantastic group. You'll hear more about what they do tomorrow. This is our latest group retreat where we brainstorm new ideas, including the ones you'll hear about tomorrow and Friday. My group is fantastic. They do everything. They make the slides. They write the papers. They buy the equipment. They run the show. And I just have the pleasure of working with them and being a cheerleader to make sure they're happy graduate students and postdocs and doing what they think they should be doing, which is have fun. So with that, I'm happy to answer questions, and thanks so much for coming.
Before we open the floor for questions, I have one note and one challenge. Note that please remember to come back tomorrow, same time. Refreshment starts at 3:30. Mm-hmm. Talk starts fall, and the same time for Friday. The challenge that I wanted to challenge students, undergraduate students, to ask questions. So if you ask questions, maybe I can get a beer for you in the
future. Oh, no, not in the future. That's the way I normally work. If there's an opportunity after dinner, for instance, if you ask a question now, either he or I is going to have to buy you a beer.
All right, so the floor now is open.
That usually prompts a lot of questions and a lot of beer.
Have you attempted or have you looked into intentionally doping carbon into your titanium oxide barrier layer to see if it would affect the catalytic properties of the material?
We haven't intentionally doped carbon. We made the TiO2 by other ways to try to get rid of the carbon that's there. Sputtering actually produces very similar amounts of carbon and nitrogen. I guess it's impurities from the chamber or something.
It's everywhere.
Yeah. It's everywhere. We've heard anecdotes that ALD grown TiO2 from titanium tetrachloride from Tickle is a good barrier film. We actually are just right now getting samples. We can't do that in our ALD because we can't use that the precursors. But there are groups that grow it. Steve George's group can grow it, and the group at Georgia Tech can grow it. And we're trying to do that to see that there's some causal relationship between having the carbon and nitrogen there and having the tunneling. Right? We don't know that. I'm very careful. We don't know that for sure. And it's very hard to say where the conduction comes from unless your energy localized somehow. E. Chorkendorf has an alternate hypothesis on how this happens. We're still going to let the scientific jury's still out on exactly how it happens.
Well, you mentioned you're making the silicon microbot. You mentioned the one more phase. I'm wondering what's the reason for that? Is it due to better light absorption? And whether this principle is also applicable to other photoelectrodes? And when we mention the when we are making the photoelectrodes, we always consider about different structures like rod structure, tube structure.
Yeah.
Do we still need to consider the crystal phase?
Oh yeah. Okay. Well, that's more than one question. The crystal phase is okay. So yes, you still consider the crystal phase. We do know that in all the systems I showed you that were high efficiency, with one exception, that they were, to demonstrate them, made out of emitters. They were buried emitters there. So on the silicon PN junctions, we made a buried emitter. We've shown that you don't have to do that in the silicon case. You can do interface engineering on the 111 surface with cobalt oxide below the nickel oxide and get almost the same voltage. We don't need the buried emitter. We would much, much like to simplify the process and not have to make buried junctions. There are two reasons for that. And that means you need to worry about the crystal face, right? Because if you have to worry about the flatbed potential, then you need the crystal face. The one reason is just cost, right? If you've got to make the buried junction, if you noticed we had the oxide boot, there's a shunt reduction, and things like that. It's just a lot more process steps. The second is, I think, more fundamental than that. Why would you ever be doing photoelectrochemistry or making an emitter and taking a perfectly good finished solar cell and dunking it into a corrosive liquid environment in the first place, as opposed to holding it outside and building a solar panel and hooking it up to an electrolyzer? The only compelling reason to that goes back to why photoelectrochemistry exists in the first place, is that you can use and make very cheap materials that you couldn't make solar panels out of efficiently. And for instance, in most materials, when you try to make emitters, silicon especially, if you have polycrystalline or small grain materials, the dopants diffuse down the grain boundaries and introduce majority carrier shunts. So you can't make good emitter-based solar photovoltaics out of polycrystalline or microcrystalline silicon, or really any of these materials that make good photoelectrodes anyway, because the surface barrier devices work. That's where we're going. We need to go to that sweet spot where you can do things with materials and in ways with liquid junctions that you can't do by making a buried junction and then putting it in contact with the liquid. Otherwise, there's no advantage. And so I think we've kind of gotten a little misguided here by kind of demonstrations of efficiency that don't take into account, you know, if you're going to just have a finished solar cell, why do you do this in the first place? Right. Now that was the answer to your last question about the bid. And you asked me about 1 molar KOH, right? And I think that was in the context of etching the microwires, or was it in the context of why we do our electrochemistry to oxidize water there? So which in the context is that? When you asked me about 1 molar base.
No, I didn't ask that.
Okay, then what was the first question you asked me?
Phases.
No, just why 1-1-1 phase?
Oh, why the 1-1-1 phase? For silicon, that's the thermodynamic growth plane. And so I alluded to it, but there's a lot in this, right? So if we want to grow a single crystal, we have to grow along the 1-1-1 growth plane to get the growth to occur normal to the surface. If we grow along the 1-0-0 growth plane, then we'll grow 1-1-1 facets thermodynamically, and then they bump into each other. Right? So the only growth plane that we can have is a at these temperatures at 1,000 degrees that will grow is the thermodynamically favored growth plane, which is the 1-1-1. And to get the wires to not bump into each other and all go straight up, which we may not want, we may want to make them like blades of grass, but if we want them all straight up, then we have to start with a 1-1-1 oriented substrate in order to get them all to grow. Now we've actually done things on purposely miscut samples, and we've done it on the 1-0-0 sample to show they bump into each other. We've also done it on another plane, which I don't think you probably would have encountered normally. There's a paper that just came out in PhysRev Letters on these microwire arrays at an angle in the relativistic regime as sources of charged particles for proton ion therapy, for proton therapy and other cancer therapy, because in the relativistic regime there was a prediction by a physicist that these microwires at very high laser fluences would be ideal sources of protons in focused directions. We grew these microwires off axis. He was ecstatic because they worked, and so we're thinking about using them for targets for cancer therapy with these designed areas.
Questions from our students?
Oh, come on. You guys must be thirsty.
That way I have a question.
Yeah, if.
So if you switch to a smaller band gap for water oxidation,
yeah.
What do you have in mind for using water reduction? Would you switch to a larger band?
Right. Okay, so you're actually, that's a very timely question that is exactly what we're struggling with here, right? Silicon, of course, is great for the ideal in acid in the microwire array design proton reduction system, right? 1.1 EV would band gap match with a good 1.7 EV. That's a good top cell current match to the bottom. That's where you'd want to be if you were optimal everything, right? We don't have that 1.70 protected thing on top in acid, We think we probably do with gallium arsenide phosphide in base, but in base, we can't have the silicon exposed down because it etches in base, so we need to use the core shell structure, the Q-tip structure. But we think there's a credible shot to build exactly that, provided that we can grow a core shell, silicon microwire, ohmic contact, gallium arsenide phosphide shell on top of the core and that Q-tip in alkaline media. Now, you know, it's drawing to a straight. All those pieces have to work, and it won't be the end, because we actually are having trouble growing high-quality gallium arsenide phosphide epitaxially because it's not lattice matched on top of silicon. And so looking at other materials would be good. Once you start to turn it around and say, well, I'm going to use silicon as the photoanode, now that's the 1.1 EV, and then you've got to find the 1.7 EV photocathode that we don't have yet. And so you're actually right back to where I left off, in that I said, we think we have enough catalysts, with the exception of iridium oxide, to perform well, enough strategies that's not where we really need to focus. We really need to focus on the light absorbers and that tandem and growing them under conditions where everything else works. We'd like to get a substitute in the long term for the iridium oxide, but other than that, it's all in the light absorbers, in my opinion. Yeah.
Actually, it's kind of a wireless device, right? So it's so anode and cathode are, I think, actually connected through a connective layer between them. It is different from the wired.
It's wired. Well, we did it both wired and wireless.
So they can perform very similar performance.
Yeah. So. Both ways were published in that paper in Energy and Environmental Science. So we did this, where it is wireless. It's not on a substrate. It's just a tandem cell with a protected TiO2 layer, and then a catalyst on the back, an alkaline hydrogen evolution catalyst, and then our nickel oxyhydroxide on top of the TiO2 protected layer on the top. And the membrane, this is just a discrete version of the membrane embedded stuff, right? Where the material is a bigger scale than a microwire material. We kind of didn't want to go all the way to embedded at this point, right? This is like a tenth of a square centimeter, and here's the membrane. And you could see how if you shrunk it down and then put another one and another one, you would have it in the membrane embedded. But there's no wires in this, right? This is just freestanding. Now, we also did it on substrate because then we can measure the current. Here, we can only measure the gases, right? So we did it both ways, and they correlated with each other as they should.
Yeah, because in some review papers, people will mention that the wired devices maybe will provide a better ionic transportation compared with wireless devices.
Yeah, so John Newman has looked at this. And he has a paper that says wired is better than wireless. But in that paper, he kind of plays it both ways. Yes, he says that wired with grid lines carrying the electrons out is better than wireless with protons having to move. Yeah, that's certainly true according to laws of physics. But that doesn't mean that you couldn't have a minimal resistance loss change with protons moving in such a geometry that it was more cost effective to do it all wireless in this membrane than it is basically building a photovoltaic wired up to an electrolyzer. Now, I'm totally open to this and not dogmatic. If there's a way to make very, very cost effective, cheap electrolyzers, which is not the case now, and we know after 100 years of the chloralkali industry being practiced at scale, you know, 2% of the nation's electricity is used to make chlorine by electrolysis. So we know how much that costs, and it's closely related to electrolysis, because it is. And if you look in my science review, we costed that out. It would be kind of the equivalent if you had 5 cents a kilowatt hour hydrogen, which doesn't, electricity, which doesn't exist from solar, you'd still make hydrogen at the equivalent of $7 a gallon gasoline equivalent. So if there's a way to make very disruptive, ultra-low-cost electrolysis that could be fed by both wind and solar electricity, that would be very important to do. In the meantime, having not such a thing for the last 100 years on planet Earth, that means that other options, like wireless ways, should be considered, provided they could be credible. I think it's not credible if they're not safe. Right? So you have to start there, because no matter how cheap it is, no one will ever deploy something that's going to make an explosive mixture of hydrogen oxygen over active catalysts in the presence of light and heat. Right? That's just not valuing human life. So that's not going to happen. But that doesn't mean that you shouldn't be credibly working on systems that could provide options if they were developed. This is a very tricky minefield to navigate, right? And I'm telling you, you know, what I think is a solid set of conclusions, because I know there are a lot of other viewpoints on this, and I totally welcome them. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, have you, my questions are two parts. The first part, have you guys ever met any problems with any potential defects when you try to combine those two tendencies?
Yeah.
And the second question is, if that's the challenges that you met, what modifications have you done to get rid of those issues?
Yeah. Okay. So, the P.PSS is a material which still could be better, because, we found that it does make an ohmic non-completely rectifying, it's not truly ohmic contact to N plus silicon, but because its work function is very high, it does make a good ohmic contact to P silicon. So if we have P silicon down below and N plus silicon at the bases of the microwires, then we can have a decent, non-too-resistive contact between a microwire in the top and the P.PSS and a microwire in the bottom. But we would like to do a lot better. The problem is, why do we do that, not work on it more, is we know we're not going to have silicon on the top and silicon on the bottom. We're going to have some other material on the top. And so we don't want to go work on improving the P.PSS ohmic contact to a material that we know we're not going to use in the end. And we don't know what the combination is we are going to use, so we have kind of deferred on that issue. Now, on the defects, I'm sure that on a macro scale, if we tried this, there would be pinholes and defects. We made a sample set on the order of a square centimeter, and we were interested in doing that, and did publish that, to evaluate, at least under kind of ideal conditions, whether or not the membrane with embedded microwires would... You know, Nafion has these oriented water pools, right, that act to facilitate electroosmotic flow and move the protons and water through them. And if you would disrupt that orientation by virtue of having the silicon penetrating through the Nafion and changing the pools, A, might have had more gas crossover, and or B, might have been less proton conductive. And when we measured it with the microwire arrays that we used, it was so similar to Nafion itself that we said, yeah, there's at least... It can work. Okay? We didn't mean that that'd be optimal, but we found it wasn't, you know, disrupted so much that it did act as a gas blocking barrier, that it would pass protons, and that its mechanical properties were not too different from that of Nafion at those dimensions of wires and at those penetrations, that it looked like it might be okay. But it's not the material we're using in the end, and we may not need Nafion either, which is more expensive than we would like, right, if you wanted to build something. And so if you're going to have to move away from that in the end, we don't necessarily want to optimize it now with the science. We've got a lot of other, at least as big science fish to still fry. That's a limited view of where my group wants to put their effort.
Questions from our colleagues?
Okay.
ask a chemistry question. So is it water split to hydrogen, oxygen? Since we had very good understanding about hydrogen formation through metal hydride, indicating one approach. So how, do we have very good understanding about oxygen formation?
Right.
And is there a different mechanism out there, might we take a different approach in terms of design, in terms of engineering, in terms of devices? Right.
Let me answer that, try to, and then generalize it on the other side to a question that hasn't arisen but usually does. So, no, we don't have, look, we don't even have a good understanding after 100 years of the two competing mechanisms for hydrogen evolution on platinum that's been known for, you know, over 100 years as to whether or not it's a metal hydride that's protonated or two metal radical hydrogens that form H2. Is it two electrons from one site or one electron from two sites? After 100 years, there's still credible debate on both sides of that. And we're not going to solve that in the next 5 years, and I would venture that we're not going to solve on the surface the credible debate of whether or not the metal oxo is electrophilically attacked by water or whether or not there's the parallel oxygen metal oxo radical coupling mechanism that is credible to form oxygen. So I don't think we'll settle that anytime soon. Good insight into that would be helpful, but I already told you, except for iridium oxide, we already have good enough catalysts to do most of what we want to do on the water oxidation side in basic media, in alkaline media. We'd like to, if you could get insight as to whether or not it's possible to make what sounds like an oxymoron, a noble non-precious metal. That's what we need, right? It has to be stable under oxidative aqueous conditions, but not be precious.
So I guess the approach right now is you already have pretty good catalysis, even though we don't understand the mechanism.
Right.
It's more like an engineering problem. How we make it more efficient? But my question is, if there's a new kind, I just want your comments on that.
Yeah, well,
does the mechanism will change in a way approach if there's a new way?
No, I think I told. I think that in our view, the long pole in the tent is the light absorbers at this point, not the catalysts. Now, there's one, the two exceptions to that. There's the iridium oxide and acid, and there's the one I said I would answer your other question of if you should choose to keep your options open, which I'm agnostic about. And make another fuel other than water splitting, but while making oxygen, reduce something else other than water, and I'm being general because there are lots of choices. You could reduce nitrogen to ammonia. You could reduce CO2 to a reduced both liquid or gaseous fuel. And I'm personally totally agnostic about this because although people fight over both sides, if you ask the oil and energy companies, they'll say clean, cheap hydrogen is their ticket because from that, they can make anything they want, right? You can upgrade biofuels and store all the energy in the hydrogen and liquid fuels and double or triple the energy density content with a liquid hydrocarbon that you took the unsaturation and stored the energy in the CH bonds by known thermochemistry. You can replace ammonia synthesis from fossil energy, steam reforming, with clean hydrogen and make the ammonia that way directly from Haber-Bosch with hydrogen. You could make reverse water gas shift and then Fischer-Tropsch and make all your clean diesel that way too with carbon capture somehow from the air, either bio or non-bio. Or if you chose, you could instead make life more complicated potentially but simpler by actually reducing CO2 from the air in a true photosynthesis and then making liquid or gaseous fuel that then you would convert into something else, which is what we do in a refinery anyway. You know, we don't necessarily at all use at end use the fuels that we put into an oil refinery. We put in crude, then we get out other stuff. We get out gasoline and diesel and jet fuel. And there's nothing at all saying that we wouldn't continue to do that. And besides, the energy of a CH bond is almost the same as an HH bond. So what matters is not whether you're George Ola's side and want to make methanol, or you're the side and want to make hydrogen, or you want to make gasoline. You can convert one fuel into another, and the bond strengths are all about the same. And the energy conversion efficiency in refineries is about 85%. The energy that goes in comes out because of good heat management. So this is really an issue of feasibility, and I would argue that if you can't reduce 55 molar water by 2 electrons, you certainly can't reduce 400 parts per million of CO2 by 6. So we have to start somewhere, and it's logical that this is where we start. And that doesn't mean you don't work on the other things to keep options open, but the harder you make it, the less likely that you'll meet a goal and succeed in a reasonable time.
To reward myself for hosting this, I'll end today's lecture with two comments,
mm-hmm.
and both pertaining to water oxidation. The first is what to put on top of silicon.
Right.
I really encourage you guys to look at the material that you sort of choose not to look at,
iron oxide.
Yes. Last year we demonstrated that you can get close to 1%.
Yeah.
Actually modifying the surface iron oxide.
We know, we're watching the air. Okay, what's the second comment?
The second comment.
I'll talk about the iron oxide in a second.
Yeah. The second comment really related to your comment on the uranium oxide, the lack of acid active water oxidation catalyst. We sitting there, I think we have a solution for that.
Ooh, good.
This is in collaboration again with Gary Brodwick.
Good.
And we can't get around the problem. But we try to minimize the amount of uranium we use to a sub-monolayer, and it works pretty well on iron oxide.
Okay, so that would be, of course, minimization of the of the need for iridium. You can do the calculation, and we did it in one of our papers recently about how minimal the loading would have to be able to scale to terawatts level. My view on the iridium oxide, which is shared by John Turner and other people, is Dow Chemical makes something like 10 to the 9th kilograms per year of hydrogen already right now by using iridium and dimensionally stabilized anodes or ruthenium. So you could make a huge industry based on iridium oxide right now, and it's not a barrier to scalability at all, even the loadings we have. You can't get the terawatt levels probably without other tricks. But that doesn't mean that if you had the rest of the system that you wouldn't just be running away right now with using iridium oxide, right? But that does mean there's a challenge still to try to minimize this loading or replace it ultimately. On the iron oxide, yeah, we're looking at that. You're doing great stuff. Tom Hammond, my old postdoc, my grad student, is doing good stuff. Michael Gretzel's people are actively, and Anders Hochfeld, looking at it. I'm sure you know all this better than I do. The big disadvantages still for our demonstration purposes are we still can't get enough photovoltage out of it to push it over the top with the half a volt we get out of silicon, because when you only get 300 or 400 millivolts relative to the oxygen evolution potential, you need the 1.23 plus the over potentials. We need 1.7 volts at maximum power. We don't have that with half a volt on silicon and with the iron oxide yet. If we get iron oxide up to a volt, you know, that'd be great.
You get 0.8.
Yeah, but that's open circuit, not maximum power, correct?
No, this is
Right, and so we need maximum power, right? I mean, it's still great progress, but we still have maximum power issues to do. So, you know, it would be great.
That